Stephen King wrote Shawshank Redemption?
Yeah, you didn't know that?
I want to kill myself now.
Hey, Siri.
I vowed to never like anything Stephen King wrote.
Who wrote Shawshank Redemption? Hey, what's up? It's the Commuters. We're back. Today we're reviewing one of my favorite movies of all time, The Shawshank Redemption.
Also, new space. A couple of house cleaning. First of all, no Spencer here today. He is here with us in spirit, but he's in fact dead.
I thought you were going to say he's in a prison right now.
Was arrested for murdering his wife and his wife's lover.
Or anyway, false accusation.
We're doing this at a different space than we normally do. We got some cool props in the background. So
also, I have coffee sponsored by Starbucks. So Shawshank Redemption, one of my favorite movies of all time. I love this movie so much. I counted the totals. I've seen it 20 times. Every time, it just gets even better and better. I love so much about it. I love the character concepts. I love the characters, the story, the way that it's filmed, how the music goes so well, the symbolism in it. I'll get to the symbolism later, but
guys,
that's actually the end of the podcast. So thanks for tuning in. He covered just about everything we care about today.
Hold on, wait. I gotta say one thing. In that one span of time, was the most critical thing I've ever heard Will say on the podcast, and it's awesome.
Yeah.
But where has this been the whole time?
For real.
So yeah, Stephen King wrote this. Yeah. I'm sorry, Basil.
Which has really crushed my
entire Technically, universe. He's written, you didn't like The Shining either, did you?
I've never seen The Shining.
You haven't seen it. Right. He only has like two or three things I think were actually adapted well. This, Shawshank, and I think Stand By Me. To give you some background on this. Shawshank Redemption is based on a Stephen King story, but it was a short story. It was not very long. I actually read it for a class because we did a comparison between
The movie didn't follow the book then.
It didn't. Not at all.
It was not very long.
I think it depends on what it is. Like, The Dark Tower, I think, is a pretty good series.
I've heard good things.
It's a good series. The Shining is a fantastic story and a great movie.
There's a fly in here. And
there's
really
a fly annoying. In my boot. There's a lot of great stuff in this film.
Oh, yeah.
Red alone, like, it's...
The way he's portrayed in
he's
the film.
He's portrayed. Also, Morgan Freeman.
Yes. Seriously. They couldn't have picked a better role.
He is one of my favorite actors of all time. I mean, it's hard not to like him. Oh, he's so... Every time I see him on screen, I'm drawn to his entire performance. And this movie, he steals it.
Yeah.
Not to say that, who plays Andy Dufresne?
Tim Robbins.
I thought he did an amazing job.
Yeah, he's great. I don't think, like, any of the cast is bad in this movie.
No.
I think everyone does a fantastic job.
I agree with your assessment on Red being the best, pretty much, part of the movie, in my opinion, anyway. Did Morgan Freeman win an Oscar for this?
Because
he should have.
I'm not sure. I'm not sure.
Not that the Oscars matter, but...
I think he did, actually. Doing my paper. I think he did.
It's been a...
When did this movie come out? 1995?
1995.
Something like that.
It's such a good...
Which is weird because I thought it was way older than that.
So did I.
No, it does... It's funny you say that because it doesn't feel old.
If I may, I mean old in the sense that it's a classic. And it's existed my entire life, but you know how, like...
Did it strike you as, like, an 80s movie or something?
No, it just struck me as a movie that is, like, a timeless movie that could have been made at any time, but I feel like it's been around longer, because, like, the rep of Shawshank Redemption, it's considered one of the great best movies of all time. And the fact that it was made in 1995 and people put it up there with, like, some amazing movies, like, you know, Schindler's List and Citizen Kane, like, these other movies, and then people will always say, oh, well, my favorite movie is Shawshank Redemption, which is a movie that came out, to me, it just... I felt like it came out earlier just because of how impactful it is.
You're basically saying, like, it because of that impact, you thought it was, like, something that came from the golden age of, like, the 70s.
Yeah, I thought it was classics. More... I didn't realize, like, because, honestly, I mean, not to hate on the 90s, but the 90s was dour time for movies. It's funny because, like, I've never seen this movie before, and all the references in pop culture that I've seen that, like... Red specifically, a lot of his monologue gets referenced in so many movies and TV shows, and I always knew that they were referencing The Shawshank Redemption when I saw these movies and stuff, But then when I see it and I'm like here, I'm like, oh, there it is. This is the original.
I think like the monologuing in this movie alone is just like, it's been done so much since it happened.
Mm-hmm.
Not, by the way, can we talk about the fact that this is a movie that makes monologues work?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's so rare for me to like enjoy good monologues that mm-hmm. have, or rather narration monologues and all that. It didn't ever take me out of the film.
No. No.
Which is something
that added to it.
Yeah.
It added to it a lot.
It brought so much flavor to the film, and whenever we were without it, I was like, oh god, I kind of miss hearing Morgan Freeman talk about stuff.
Another thing, the musical score. That one scene that really gets me is that when the white bus is pulling into Shawshank Prison, and you hear the violins just gently playing. That is one of the best scenes in the movie by far.
Okay, another surprise, I didn't know he was in this movie, which kind of, I started laughing because of it. Clancy Brown is in this movie.
Yeah.
And I didn't know this. And the funniest thing is, Clancy Brown plays as Mr. Krabs in the in SpongeBob. He plays as Mr. Krabs. One of his favorite phrases is, get back to work.
Get back to work, Mr. Squidward.
He says it in Shawshank Redemption.
Yeah, he plays the guard.
I was laughing so hard. That was amazing.
Something about the whole sequence of Andy, like...
escaping?
Yeah, it's just one of the most beautiful sequences in, like, any movie I've actually ever... It's beautiful.
Yeah.
When he comes out of the pipe.
Yeah.
And it's just... It's
him
raining. Shout out to my teacher who did film as literature. He had us read and that, and he was my... real experience in getting into like how you construct a story in film.
Yeah.
And he makes this point that scene is both powerful and moving because it feels like a rebirth for the character of Andy Dufresne at that
literally it is.
Yeah, it's like baptizing him essentially.
Well, it's more than like, it's cleansing it's him both, of his right because he comes literally out of a womb, so to speak. Like he crawls out of this disgusting
thing into
a puddle of water, and then he rips off his clothes and he gets all clean and stuff. It is a literal
world
and
story.
Figurative.
It's a great scene. I feel uncomfortable. I know it's like it is very on the nose. It's very obvious.
It's very obvious, but it works.
It doesn't. It feels earned.
Yes. Oh yeah.
Another scene, when Andy got red, the harmonica. That symbolism. Here's the thing. In my paper, I wrote how that harmonica symbolized the main theme of the movie, hope. Because when Red first got the harmonica, he gently played it, you know? Playing that soft tune when he first got it. But as the movie went on, he saw that Andy became more of a character that was liked by everyone. And that harmonica stuck with him. And that harmonica was their friendship as well.
We're really kind of just jumping all over the place, but whatever.
Well, it's fine. This is a movie where I think it works to jump around.
And he has the harmonica, and he plays it for, like, he doesn't really play it. He goes, and stops. It's almost like...
It's like a soft hum. It's a soft hum.
He's entertaining this idea of hoping again. Like, at that moment. But then he, like, puts
it
away quickly.
Because he lost all hope, because he's been rejected so many times on getting out.
Yeah, and so he's afraid, though, which is why he doesn't actually commit to playing it just then. He's just a teeny bit of hope there, but he's afraid of it.
You know what's great about that hope, though? It's the fact that we see someone else who actually got out, but he was at that point where it was just, he couldn't come back. The character's name.
Brooks.
Brooks.
Oh, Brooks.
Everything about that sequence is one of the most depressing things.
It
I've
really
seen
is.
In, like, you feel it, because when he's been institutionalized for so long that going back into society is... impossible.
Yeah.
It makes you realize that being institutionalized, like, regardless of what your crime was, it
changes you.
It ends you. No, it ends your life almost.
Yes. Well, that is your life, right?
Yeah.
And it's, you do that for 50 years. Like, imagine that you're working as a carpenter for 50 years, and then all of a sudden, you have to be a mechanic.
Yeah, you can.
And if you can't, and after doing it for 50 years, you know how long 50 years is? Doing the same thing?
It's 50 years.
The adjustment is too much for a person. That was the point with Red, is he was in the prison, I think, for 40 years. Which, like, I think that kind of... He was almost there. He was so close to being where Brooks was. And he was where Brooks was. Because Brooks was here.
Yeah.
so was Red.
Yeah.
Anyways, this movie's more clever than I give it credit for.
Like it was written by an incredible individual.
Stephen King.
Yeah. What?
A lot of the foreshadowing, which, like, I didn't know what it meant, but I kind of recognized some of it's foreshadowing, like chess. He's talking about how much he loves chess, and I'm like, this dude's setting up something. At that moment, like, I'm not gonna lie, throughout the whole movie, I knew he had something going on. Like, he had a plan going on. The entire movie, I knew there was something going on behind the scenes. As somebody who's, like, heard pop culture and stuff, as soon as I saw the poster on the wall, I was like, there's a ton behind that poster. And I knew it, maybe because at some point in my mind, I vaguely remember seeing a part of this movie, or I vaguely remember a reference to this movie where they had the poster, which isn't necessarily, it's not a detriment to the movie. It's just, you know, that's a trope. There's a poster, there's a hole behind it. So I kind of knew that was coming. I didn't realize the breadth, like, the width, the scale of his revenge, if you will. Like, it's very, I mean, more foreshadowing. Count of Monte Cristo is literally held up in the prison. He's like, yeah, I think you'll like that book. And he's like, it's about a prison escape. See, that was the thing. I was going to compare this to Silence because they're very similar in some ways where it's like a very hard, like, as the movie's happening, a lot of terrible stuff happens to the characters that you like, and you don't want this terrible stuff to happen to them, and it just keeps happening, keeps getting worse. The difference between these two movies is the way they handle hope. And I said when we did Silence, I didn't like the way they handled hope in Silence. I didn't think it was enough.
And this movie, you loved it.
I loved it. Because this, I mean, yeah, it's like, it's a little bit Hollywood at the end, you know, they get the happy ending, but it's like, they didn't just get a happy ending.
No.
They earned it, mm-hmm. and they survived. Andy Dufresne was put in prison, like, he did not commit the crime, so, like, at least that's what the makers of the film want you to think, so I think he didn't commit the crime. And...
Well, I tell you.
He loses 19 years of his life over this and does all this stuff in the prison to help all these people who are terrible lives. Most of them are convicted felons. I mean, what's his face? Red is a convicted felon and he owns up to it. Andy isn't, and he still goes through all this terrible stuff. But at the end, he gets his...
He comes out on top. After he gains... He gets his, basically, revenge.
Yeah, well, that, and he gets, like, his self-actualization. Like, think about it, because it wasn't just the prison. His wife was cheating on him, who he loved his wife. He really loved her, and he just didn't know how to show it. And so she was cheating on him with another dude, and then they both get killed, and he was thinking about killing them. Not them, I think he was thinking about killing the guy. But he didn't, and then he goes to jail over it. After his wife is killed, who he loved, he goes to jail, and now he has to deal with all this awful stuff being in jail. And then 19 years later, he gets out and gets, like, his self-actualization of Z Watanejo and the money and all of that great stuff.
Shawshank makes a point that hope is something we're chasing.
Yeah.
And we get to see that through the whole film, that there's just something worth it.
Yeah.
Even though all this horrible shit.
Yeah, one of the like, hardest moments for me was when Tommy died.
Oh, Tommy.
I was like... Dude, you, like, I, that's when I, like...
Like, seriously.
Like, I mean, I already didn't like the warden, like, because he's clearly the antagonist of the film, but, like, at that point, I was like, he went from me being like, oh, he's just a dumb antagonist, to being like, oh, I really want to kill this motherfucker.
Yeah, exactly. Well, he did it himself at the end, so...
Yeah, he did.
Isn't it crazy how you have a bunch of convicted felons and just horrible people, and you end up loving so many of them because
right,
of how this
right.
movie
yeah.
portrays them? I think that's one of the most important parts about how they grow these characters.
Mm-hmm.
That, and it doesn't do a thing where it, like, it doesn't glorify the prisoners, or at least all of them. And it doesn't try to make you care about all of them, because some people are so mad. Like, the in the beginning, the whatever, the sisters, whatever they were called, who kept trying have their way with Andy Dufresne, they were disgusting, terrible people.
Mm.
And the point was, like, this is what prison's like. It's not great. Even for Red and them, they all still got treated awfully by the guards, and the guards would just kick the shit out of them. I mean, they killed that heavier dude right away. That dude was killed by Clancy Brown's character.
Yeah.
And it's just like that. Like, that's it did a very good job, I thought, of being, like, giving you a kind of a little bit of a Hollywood eyes, like, oh, you know, we got these quirky characters, but also reminding you constantly that this is prison, and you could die like that.
They add a Hollywood edge to everything.
I
think that mostly comes in the ending. It's very, very happy, which is so strange considering how much of the film is just not.
Yeah.
But I think that's a necessary thing in this case. It's one of the few times I think Hollywoodizing a film has actually worked really well.
Oh, I agree.
I mean, there was a lot of ups. I mean, most of the film wasn't depressing. There was a lot of ups in the film. You know, when Andy got the built the library, when he was doing the taxes for all the prison guards, when when he was doing all the taxes for the prison guards, that got me. That was funny. That was really good. I mean, you take a convicted felon and you have him do all your do all the taxes for the prison guards. That just kills me.
I have a question. What's everyone's favorite scene, starting with Sky?
Other than the beginning scene with the white truck pulling into Shawshank, one of my favorite scenes by far has to be when the captain of the prison guards was holding Andy like over the. Holding him like on the edge of the building, and being like, "We're gonna," seems like he's gonna have himself a little accident, you know, and then Andy goes into this thing where he's like, "I can help you, you know, you're doing this all wrong. You can get more money if you do this and this and this." And he's like, "What?" And then he just pulls him back, and that scene just.
So it's funny you say that because my favorite scene is right after that when they have the beers.
Oh, with the beers, yeah, that's a good
that's
one
my
too.
Favorite scene in the entire movie.
That's a good one
just
too.
Like, and it. Red's monologue at that moment when he's like, you know, we're just there sitting on a roof. This could be our roof. We could be free men with some beers. And I was like, this is such a great moment. Like, after a lot of awful stuff. Like, that, I feel like that was, like, one of the first major ups in the movie as far as, like, uplifting parts. Because you had Andy constantly being assaulted. You had all this terrible stuff happening. And then this moment happens and you're like, this is pretty good.
Hey, that's pretty good. Brooks's is probably just because it's such a, I know you two talk about the happy stuff, but, like, the sad stuff,
Brooks's situation.
It speaks to me. On this, like, really downer way that, like, it reminded me really hard of, like, how, you know, as I said, just it juxtaposized to words to the overall hope of the film, and then you get the utter failure of that hope.
Right.
Also, yes, there's a fly. I see it.
Yeah, I know. It's...
You get both, basically. Right. And I feel like that duality is really important. And that's why I like that so much, is because they could have not done any of that. No. They could have cut it out, and then the movie would still probably be good.
Yeah.
But I don't think you would have this, like, clashing of feelings and emotions that you really need to make a good story. I definitely think you do need both to have an effective story. Yes. That's why Silence, like, kills me when I think back to it.
It's
I love
the
movie and all. Yeah, I enjoyed the movie for what it was.
Well, it's very well made. Where it's not a bad movie by any stretch of the imagination. It's a movie I did not like. Not a movie I thought was bad. Shawshank Redemption.
Yeah, bro, I agree.
Shawshank.
What do you think of the title for that? Because I don't believe the Shawshank Redemption is what the short story was called.
So, there's a few issues I have with the movie. I love the movie a lot, but there's some issues I have. This fly is dragging me.
Welcome back to Basil Hates Flies.
Anyways, the issues
flies. I think it's
are
a gnat, actually,
as follows. No, it's a fruit fly. The issues are as follows.
Sucks to your ass more.
The movie's Andy it's pretty much between Andy Dufresne and Red, I feel like, are the two main protagonists. Mostly Andy Dufresne's the main protagonist, and then Red's the supporting protagonist. And it's the person who you would say gets redeemed, because Andy Dufresne doesn't need redemption. He never committed the crime. He escapes from Shawshank, but he doesn't need redemption. He needs to move on from his dead wife and from that old life he had, but I don't think he needs redemption, because there's nothing to redeem him for. Red. His name's Red. Shawshank Redemption. Red.
Can you stop?
Redemption.
Can you please?
Red Dead Redemption.
Yeah, if we stop.
Anyways, I think the redemption is talking about Red. That's the point of the title and the point of the... It's talking about him, because he's the one who's... At the end, he has the choice between no hope, Brooks' way, hope, Andy's way. He has the duality presented before him, and he gets the choice. Andy, his goals were set from the beginning. He was breaking out of this prison. He was helping people. He had a perfect set goal to do. I get why it's called Shawshank. It's not really about the prison, though. I mean, you could say it is, because at the end, the warden dies, and the prison gets all the... It got the library, and it gets all the better, but It's about Red and it's about Andy, and it's about Red being kind of saved by Andy.
It's about friendship.
It's about lovers.
Are you saying something about yourself, Faze?
I'm kidding.
Hey, you know what they say. It wasn't about the dreamers, but the friends that we made.
Nail along the way!
I very much think Andy needed redemption. You gotta think about it. This isn't redemption for himself. This is a societal form. The world put him away because the world didn't understand. There's a lot of layers to it that you can point it in either direction, but the way I always saw it is Andy Dufresne needed that redemption as a way of, like, cleansing himself. More like he's cleansing himself of the prison.
Yeah.
Of the horrible things he went through. Everything that he experienced while he was in Shawshank. Yeah, there's a lot of, like, high points and a lot of low points. It's like ridding himself of that time that he was stuck there wrongfully. It's almost like cleaning yourself of the filth that you were forced to wallow in. A la why he gets rained on, you know, all that stuff that happens during his escape. It's a very sort of big moment for him to... But I do agree that Red does need redemption, and I do think that this film covered that too.
I like the length of it. I feel like they put a lot of stuff in there that really fit, and if they shorten it down, they think they might have missed an aspect of some important part of the plot. And the thing is that it's a wholesome movie. It's long, but that length doesn't really deprive me of enjoying it, or whoever else likes it. They might complain about the length, they might not. But I think that the length of the movie doesn't affect this film for me at all. I can't honestly find anything wrong with it that much.
So there's one, this is a nitpick. Obviously these are mostly nitpicks. We all enjoyed the movie.
Yeah, I definitely still put it on that, like,
yeah, it's one of the greatest of all time.
I mean, if you guys say, I'll probably think about that.
But this is a nitpick I have. So the movie takes place over 19 years, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
20 years are at this prison. Clancy Brown's character is a guard. He's not the warden. I could kind of buy that he would be warden. It's kind of weird that you'd be a warden for that long, especially after he made all that money, why he didn't just retire. But the guard, and then the guard killing somebody when it's like he probably has adult children now and like who probably have kids. He's like a grandpa at that point, maybe. Like, that was when I was kind of like, okay, that's a little cartoonish, right? Like, the fact that the person who killed Tommy was Clancy Brown's character. I mean, maybe it's he trusts him so much, he's the only one he could trust to do it. But I didn't think he'd still be employed there. I feel like he'd have been retired by then.
So, like, you're saying, like, time frame wise, you thought he would have been gone by that point?
He wouldn't be a guard. Like, that's a physical, strenuous job, and he's older.
Objection! I don't really fully agree with that because, I mean, there are people who have literally been in that. Like, I have a, there was a psychologist or a, like, a physician that went to prisons and stuff, and that taught one of my classes, and she was, like, in her, like, 60s. So it's not actually that weird. I know it's a demanding job, but I think it's capable for some people. If you've been pushing yourself to be physically prepared for that kind of situation your whole life, he's been doing it for that long, I don't find it all that weird that he might keep doing it. Plus, who knows, maybe he really enjoys his job.
That's a fair point.
Yeah.
That's like getting in the mind of a character and then like saying you're going to determine what they do. You gotta ride that line. You can't always give a perfect answer for someone's actions.
Yeah.
That's something that's really interesting whenever you hear someone say, well, this character didn't think like a person. I'm like, well, how would a person think? We all are, like, stupid. People do really dumb things.
People be dumb.
Some people also just do things that are really irrational. Mm-hmm. So, I mean...
He says as he looks at me.
I mean, you are the one swatting at a fly. The only issue... Yeah, I mean, I think those are nitpicks. For
well,
sure.
Definitely nitpicks.
Definitely nitpicks. I think mine about length is a nitpick too, to be honest.
Yeah.
The only reason I say that is because, like, I'll be honest, sometimes I just don't feel like watching longer movies.
Yeah.
And as much as I love this movie, sitting down and watching it in its entirety, you gotta commit to it.
Yeah.
I commit to it every time.
Yeah, that's why something, it's worthwhile.
It is.
I'm saying it's...
It's something
that I get what you're saying.
Yeah. Like, we never get, like, big blockbusters that are this length. So something like the Avengers movies,
recently. Yeah.
Yeah. So long.
Yes.
And that's the thing, is like, I feel like if you're gonna do a long movie, you've gotta be substantial enough to make it where I wanna watch it again and again and again, even with that length. I think the length of a movie is really important.
Yes.
Especially with the genre you're going.
Yes.
That's why horror films are so short usually.
Yes.
Like 90 minutes.
Yeah, seriously. And
they should be shorter.
I feel like the context of the movie, the way the plot moves and the way the characters move around, I would say that the length doesn't affect it as much. I feel like that the length actually helps it. Because you have...
It gives you the time to take in everything
that's going on. And let you think about the characters in their entirety.
Yeah, that's fair. I could definitely see that. That's why, like I said, my thing is a nitpick.
Yeah.
I feel like it's just me being like, I gotta put too much time in a movie. All right, we'll let Will go last, because this is his favorite movie. So I feel like he...
You didn't get the fly, Will.
What was that?
I didn't get it either.
Where are you?
A seal?
I would put it as one of the films that I would view as one of the most important out there. It's definitely up in that, like... top 50 list of movies I recommend everyone see at some point in their life. It's yes. That good. It's that well made. It's that engrossing. It is a little long, but apparently I think I'm a big baby in that regard. Also, the short story is pretty interesting if you ever get the chance to read it. It's the same essential story, but there's a couple differences. It's actually really interesting to see how they took something that was of its length, adapted it into a film, and the film flew with it. It took it, it soared, as opposed to the short story, which I was pretty bored reading.
There's
like most Stephen King novels.
So, this was my first time watching Shawshank Redemption. I'm no longer a Shawshank virgin. I have now seen a movie. I think it's very, 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 very overrated. No, I'm kidding. I actually liked it a lot more than I actually thought I would, because a lot of the time... I get a little jaded, you know, so many people tell me how great things are, how amazing things are, how I have to watch this, and then I watch it, and I'm like, oh, that was pretty good, I guess. My point is, there's a reason that this movie has the acclaim that it has, and it's pretty obvious when watching it why it's stuck with the public, like, what's sphere?
It's spherical! Spherical!
It's really a masterpiece of a film.
You know what I just realized we should have said? This is very much the quintessential prison movie.
Yes.
I can't think of another one that does
that. That is, you know what, in fact, let me say this. I say that this is, in fact, the quintessential prison movie.
Such a...
Anyways.
It's a thing.
It's fantastic. It's worth a watch for anybody who wants to... I mean, if you are into film like I am, if you're really into... Which is a lot of people probably be like, oh, if you're into film, how come you haven't seen Shawshank Redemption and The Shining? Get into it. I've now seen Shawshank Redemption. It's a movie you have to watch, but it is an amazing film. It's one of the best ones I've ever seen, really, honestly, and which is, it's crazy to me that I've never seen it. And it's surprisingly approachable. I don't know, I'm kind of the person who's like, I see the concept on paper and I'm like, how's a prison make movie? Like, you see the trope or the genre and you're like, okay, I know what I'm getting, right? It's like superhero movies now. You're like, oh, this is a superhero movie. They're going to fight bad guys. It's a prison break. They're going to be sad and they're going to escape from prison again. But it's a lot more than that. It's a lot more than the sum of its parts. It's amazing. And it deserves all the accolades it gets. And I hope it wins an Oscar this year.
So, Shawshank for me is like an ice cream sundae. So, you've got
vanilla ice cream, which is Andy Dufresne.
You have vanilla? Okay. The ice cream, the fudge, and the whipped cream are all my other movies, right?
He's like, oh yeah, it's a prison movie with a black and white guy and we got ice cream and fudge and whipped cream.
Okay, I wasn't thinking of it like that, okay, Basil? You perv. But I'm just saying that Shawshank Redemption is the cherry on top for all my movies. I'm saying that Shawshank Redemption is the top number one movie for me if I were suggesting anything. Because it has a bunch of symbolism. It's got that, yeah, of course, Basil was saying that, you know, you think it's just another generic, you know, prison escape movie, right? But it's not.
Wrong.
It's got a lot. You're wrong. Wrong.
You're right. It's less than that.
It's even more than less than half of a quarter of it.
What?
Mm-hmm. Math? I love this movie because of the symbolism. You know, the characters, how they interacted with each other, how they grew, you know, to know each other, how they interacted, how they just...
bonded, right?
Yeah.
And in the ending, you get that final scene where you might tear up a bit. I teared up a tiny bit every time I see that final scene. I felt the feels. Where they're on the beach, and then Red comes over, and they both embrace in a hug, and the credits start playing. I'm like, this is such a good ending to a movie. You know? Because Andy got revenge on Shawshank Prison by sending out all the...
criminal activities.
Yeah, criminal activities and all the other stuff. And he basically went incognito with a false name for the rest of his life.
Which he set up like a half hour earlier in the movie, which was awesome.
Which is really cool.
They set that up and they paid that off. A lot of nice stuff.
A lot of stuff going for this movie. So if you like movies that are just different in a way that you think that they might just be all the same old generic type of movies, watch this movie and you will, and your mind will be changed forever.
We shall now talk about the next movie that we've all agreed, except Spencer because he's not here, but he'll have to agree to it.
It's probably
going to
be Joker.
It's going to be Joker.
Yeah, it's going to be Joker. I'm really excited. Joaquin Phoenix, I love him. And then after that, I already know what I'm suggesting.
What?
Well, he's not going to say it now.
Not going to say it.
You're right. I'm not going to say it now, but let me tell you, Hoo-Boy is in an anime movie.
No!
Oh, get over it. You like Princess Mononoke. My suggestion won't be bad either.
I don't like any anime movie. They're all garbage.
Wait, we didn't end the podcast properly.
Oh,
sit back down, you peasant. Well, this is it for the Commuters podcast for today's episode. We'll see you next time when we review The Joker. See you next time.
Okay.